from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I welcome you this morning with joy, gratitude, and thanksgiving to our Father's house of worship. A very special word of welcome is extended to any first-time visitors who are with us this morning, and also to all of those individuals who are joining us via social media. May we be blessed by our fellowship together and by the warmth of Christ's presence as we have come to worship Him this morning. Please continue to remember in your prayers the persons listed in our bulletins. Add to that list kindly Mrs. Betsy Pinder, who will be seeking medical treatment for colon cancer. Mr. Hubert Aubrey, who fell and fractured his hip a few days ago and was scheduled to have surgery 10 a.m. this morning. Brother Percy Sands, who will be leaving on Thursday to have surgery in Florida. And Mrs. Jackie Kemp, who is recovering from recent hospitalization. The Bahamas Conference of the Methodist Church will be having their central council this Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. The link will be published when it is received. Please notice in your bulletins the thank you note from Sister Marcia Case. Our offering for the caring fund will be received later on in our service, so do keep that in mind. And next Sunday we shall be celebrating our harvest Thanksgiving. So if you have any special fruits and veggies that you would like to bring sometime during the week, you'll receive them gladly and have them displayed in the front of the church. So sorry that we will not be able to have the harvest Thanksgiving supper. And finally, it's always a joy to celebrate birthdays with persons from our church family. And this morning, we celebrate with several individuals: Nicolette Allen, Sherry Ann Bellamy, Jay Burrows, Rhoda Clare, Petra Marshall, Vernie Neely, Barry Newbold, Odinga Sawyer, and Paulette Sawyer, who will be celebrating her 70th birthday. So let's celebrate with them as we sing together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into Hades. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
This morning. And as the word of Scripture reminds us, that you inhabit the praises of your people. Come now and inhabit our hymns of faith, our praying, our giving, and every aspect of this service as we render it to you as our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving for your blessings and goodnesses to us. We say with the psalmist this morning, we will bless the Lord. His praise will continually be in our mouths. As we come this morning, we also come, Father, with our petitions, our requests. For your word reminds us that we have a high priest who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And he invites us to come boldly to the throne of grace, so that we may find grace and mercy to help in our time of need. We continue to remember, Father, those from our fellowship who are still grieving the loss of their and precious ones. As we have been, we continue to lift them into your presence, and may they sense the nearness of the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our moments of sorrow and grief and loss. May they know that they are still being surrounded by the love and the prayers and thoughts of brothers and sisters in faith as we journey with them through the season of sorrow. We remember also those whose names were mentioned this morning, who need a special touch from your hand, who need your grace of healing and restoration in their lives. Sister Betsy Pinder, Sister Jackie Kemp, Brother Percy Sands, as he will be leaving shortly for medical attention, and also for Brother Hubert Aubrey, who at this moment is undergoing surgery. Lord, we pray that you will draw near to each one of them. Enfold them in your loving, compassionate, and healing arms, and may they sense the ministry of your Spirit in these moments in their lives. Continue now, Lord, to meet with us and to be with us as our worship experience continues this morning. May every aspect of this service be rendered to you as an offering and a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And may at the end of this service this morning, we will indeed would have seen you more clearly, loved you more nearly, dearly, and walk with you more nearly. Receive now our prayers as we offer in the name of Jesus, your Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
as we prepare to receive our gifts of love to the Father this morning, we sing hymn 595, 94th in thy name, O Lord, my God. We shall remain seated as we sing the first four verses and stand on verse 5.
Give ear, O Lord, unto to my prayer and attend to the voice of my supplication. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee, for thou art, will answer me. Among the gods, there is none like unto thee. O Lord, neither are they any words that are unto thy word. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee. O Lord, and I shall glorify thy name. For thou art great and doest wondrous things. Thou art God alone. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Brother Garfield. We sing now the chorus, I will serve thee because I love thee. We shall sing this two times. This will be followed by our second scripture, which will be read by Mrs. Celinda Pinney.
Received 5 talents, came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents besides that. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid, and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gathered where I had not strawed. Thou oughtest then, therefore, to have put my money to the exchanges, and then at my coming they should have received my own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath. And cast ye that unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks to Sister Linda for reading the second lesson for us. We sing again 319, verses 1, 3, and 4. And during the singing of this hymn, the offering for the caring fund will be, give me the faith which can remove and sing the mountain to a plain. 390. Fellowship, which you've already enjoyed, the privilege of your time, and the gift of your presence. And your presence is a gift to each of us this morning, but above all, a gift to our Lord as we have assembled to worship him. And I conclude with a note again of thank you to all of those who have led us during this time of worship. Thank you for your ministry. Brother Earl comes now with the ministry of the word.
Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a surprise. I'm reminded of the bishop who went to visit one of his parish churches, and when he got there to have church, only three people showed up. So he asked the priest, "Didn't you let them know I was coming?" He said, "No, I didn't, but they found out anyhow." This morning, we're going to get rid of the humor right away, so we'll be done with that. I know you're used to sermons being either 3-point or 4-point, but this morning's service will be pointless. Now for our text this morning, Matthew 25 verse 18 says, "But the man who had received the one talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money." And the topic is, have you hidden or have you buried your talent? Let us pray. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Amen. Now, in our reading from the New Testament, we read the parable of the talents, of the five, the two, and the one. And I was looking to see what was a talent worth. I didn't get all the answer I wanted, but I gather a talent was the weight measurement, weighed somewhere between 70 and 100 pounds. So a talent was a lot of money. It was worth a lot. Sometimes we tend to think of the man with the one talent didn't have much to work with like the others did, but it was still considerable. As a matter of fact, when Jesus told the parable about the unforgiving servant, he referred to the servant who was forgiven for owing 10,000 talents. And that, if we figured in money today, would have been in the billions of dollars. And that sounds a bit off, but you have to remember, a parable is just told to illustrate a point, that one was big and one was small. But we're not going to deal with money this morning. We're going to talk more about talents as being abilities or gifts that we receive. And I know most of us, from little children growing up, we've had our talents or abilities, shall we say. We've had them challenged. I know I can only speak personally from being a child in Sunday school. When Christmas came around, we all had to have our little reading, or we had to sing a verse. And I somehow seem to remember singing, "I Said the Donkey, Shaggy and Brown," from the Christmas sort of stories. And my other memory from childhood, and I don't know if I remember it right or not, was I always had a good memory. I could always remember things. That isn't true today. Today, I'm like the man who went to the doctor and said, "Doctor, you have to help me." Doctor said, "Well, what's happening?" He said, "Well, I can't remember anything." And the doctor said, "Well, how long have you had this problem?" The man said, "What problem?" Now, back to my childhood. When I started school at age like 5, I guess, in our school, the individual teacher didn't take the register. The head teacher marked the whole school. And I'd say we had probably 100 and some children in school. But you would meet in the big hall, the little ones would be up front. and the head teacher would call off all the names. And somewhere along the line, they found out that I remembered the order of the register when it was called. So I was embarrassed whenever I went to visit Annie's or Otto. I had to call off the register, right? Now I can't remember none of it. But I do remember, if you were there, your name was called, you said present. If you weren't there, some family member had to give, say why you weren't there. And there was a little boy who said his sister was sick. He said she had the bubbles. But we know all through the years we've had shows, even local shows, and U.S. I guess we know more about U.S. TV, Ed Sullivan Show, or America's Got Talent. My only talent in the music. Well, I sing with everybody, but I do a better lip sync than I do singing. And I know some of those who are around can remember when we had youth group talent shows. Mm-hmm. And my choice was to lip sync Tony Williams and the Platters with the Great Pretender. But anyways, we had all of those things we had, which we had to test what talent we had. And a man once said he was telling his friend, I have a lot of hidden talent. And the friend asked him, well, what are they? He said, I don't know, they're still hidden. But we're going to get through this quick. They were having talent auditions. A man takes his dog in to see the man who's holding the audition, said, I got a dog here who can talk. And the man said, prove it. He said, okay, I'll tell. He speaks to the dog. He asks the dog, how does sandpaper feel? The dog answers, rough, rough. And so he asks the dog again, what is it? What do you have that you put shingles on top of the house? He said, roof, roof. And so he asked him another one. He said, who was the greatest baseball player that the Yankees ever had? And the dog said, Ruth, Ruth. The talent scout said, get out of here. You know, this dog is only barking. So when they get on the sidewalk, the dog says to his master, should I have said DiMaggio? Anyway, I just we'll pass on a lot of them, but I'll go. I'm trying to get something fresh or new. But I read one. It said, "I've never watched the Kardashians, so I really don't know who they are. But I've heard of Kim Kardashian and Kanye West. If anybody heard of them, but they said." Kim and Kanye have invented a new style of music. It's called plastic rap. I told it to some young people and they knew what I was talking about. Maybe us older people don't. And the other one said, the young man told his girlfriend, I think I have the virus. And she said, why do you think that? He thought he had the coronavirus. He said, because I read that one of the symptoms is that you lose your taste. And he said, for a brief moment, I thought that Justin Bieber was talented. Okay, we're finished with that. Now, this morning I thought what I would do, I'll check the time. That we would try to put the parable of the talents in a more modern, if you like, setting. And remember this morning, we're looking more at our talents as abilities rather than just money. And so, as I see it, the pastor was going on furlough. He'd been working for 10 years. Without a holiday, and he needed a year off, so he decided that he was going off for the year. But while he was gone, he needed to have things organized for when he was gone so that everything would run smoothly. So he called together his congregational board, and they appointed several people to have different duties, different jobs to do. And of course, as in the story of the talents, some people have more talent than others, I guess. And so Brother Jones was given five job descriptions, five things that he had to do. He was a lay preacher, so he was put in charge of seeing that they had preachers every week, including himself. He was a good organizer, so they put him in charge of the congregational board. He also dealt with adults, with seniors, and shall we say more with adult people, so they gave him the Sunday school adult class, and he was also in charge of the men's group, the ladies' group, the focus group, all those people. And then he knew how to handle money, so they made him the treasurer. And since he was a lawyer by trade, they appointed him to look into whatever legal problems would come up while the minister was gone. So that was the one with the five talents. Then Brother Smith, he had two talents. He worked well with children and with young people. So they put him in charge of the Sunday school, the youth groups, and so forth, all to do with children. And he also was good with music. So they put him in charge of the choir and the music and all those sort of things. But then Brother Brown, he only had one talent, and so they made him the person who would look after the properties. He would take care of the church and the hall and the manse and see that everything on that level was working well. So the minister goes on holiday, and when he comes back, he calls the congregational board back together. And again, I'm sure there were others who were given other jobs to do, but we just focus on these three. So he calls them together, and he gets a report, first of all, from Brother Jones. And Brother Jones reports that things are going well, congregation is up, and if we want to follow the Bible, the congregation is doubled, and things are going really well. The board is functioning properly. The Sunday school, the adult Sunday school, the men's group, the focus group, they're not only meeting, but they're taking active part in worship services and in outreach ministries. And as far as being a treasurer, all the bills are paid. And there's money in the bank. And they've been doing various charities and whatnot. And fortunately, there were no legal problems. None of the members went to fight. And I don't think that could happen in one church. I don't mean physically now, but I mean there were no disagreements among the members. Can you imagine that for 1 year? Wouldn't that be something? And so then he calls Brother Smith. Brother Smith said, yes, youth groups are going well, Sunday school is up. Actually, we took the Sunday school scripture exam, and we won this year, and we hadn't even been taking it before. And then he said, music is going well. The Christmas concert is still going on. We've had an Easter program, and we have various groups singing. The men and the women sing on Father's Day and on Mother's Day, and we have youth choirs, children's choirs, everything going well. But then we come to the last, Brother Brown. Now, if you want to substitute sister instead of brother in all of them, it's okay. I'm not a chauvinist, right? So you could use female or male. Brother Brown, what's happening. The minister comes, the church is in disarray. The hall looks like it hadn't been clean in months, and everything has gone totally to the pack. Now, I know we'll say, in reality, if the church is going that good, somebody else will do it. But remember, we're just making a point. And so he says, you know, the minister says to him, what happened? Well, why did you do the job you were supposed to do? He said, well, because they gave me a job that I didn't want. I mean, I have the ability to do it, but it's that job's got no glory. He said, no matter how you label it, even if you say I'm the maintenance engineer, I'm still the janitor. whatever you call it, there's no glory in it. And but we know in the Bible, king or the man who went away said to the servant, well, why didn't you take my money? And why didn't you invest, put it in the bank? And you could have got interest. Fortunately, that bank was not the Royal Bank. Had it been the Royal Bank, when he came back, he wouldn't have got enough interest to pay the bank charges. I went to the bank last week and asked for a copy of my statement. They said that would be $10 for the first day. Any more afterwards to get it. And plus, if he was gone a whole year, when he came back, they would have been taking it out because it hadn't been active. If you don't put it something in or take something out, it's inactive, so they throw it to the dead pile. Or I remember many years back when it was found shillings and pence, we had an account in Barclays, and it went quite a while. And then when we looked, our statements came, £5 all, £5 all, until it was all gone, right? They just charge you until they take it all out. So I guess we won't say what the minister would have done to that man. He may not have thrown him into outer darkness, but we understand the point. Now, there's nobody that has no talent at all, right? Now, you may not have what is considered as good a talent as someone else, but there are many talents that we could use in our church. There are simple things like visiting, involvement in social events, food, telephone ministry, singing in the choir, being a steward and leader. And one thing that we lack today is having somebody who listens well. A lot of us can talk, but we don't have a listening ear. Right, and that's very important, especially if someone has an issue or a problem. But one thing we have to remember about having a talent, a gift, an ability, whatever it is, you have to develop that ability. You don't just get it perfected by doing nothing. We all know our athletes, we have track and field, which is big here in the Bahamas. If our ladies or men in track and field just figured they would just up and go to the Olympics, we wouldn't be getting anywhere. Or if you're a musician, whatever teacher, preacher, whatever talent you have, it has to be developed. Just as when you take a picture, well, I'm old-fashioned here with this. Today, when you take a picture, it's on your phone or whatever. But years ago, when you took a picture, you got a negative. And until that negative was developed, you didn't realize what the picture was. And so that's how it is with our abilities. We have to develop them in order for them to work out. Or we think of it as being stone, a diamond, for example. When a diamond is cut out of the rock or wherever they get it, it's never what you want it to be. A jeweler has to take that and to shape it and fix it up and get it all shaped up before it's worth what it is. Now, recognizing our talents. Most of us do not recognize the talent that we have. And we use the example of Moses. We're going to use a couple of people from the Bible. Moses was born in Egypt. You know, he lived 40 years in the palace and then 40 years in the desert or wilderness, and then 40 years leading the children of Israel. But Moses was 80 years old before he was challenged to use his leadership ability. I'm just 2 years short of getting to my ability, right? And my talent. And so Moses, all of this while not realizing it, but he had been trained. He knew how to, he had grown up in the palace, he knew how to talk to pharaohs and kings. He had lived in the desert, he knew how to survive in the desert. And number three, he'd been used to leading sheep for 40 years. And I guess, how much more difficult can people be than sheep? And so God called him. But even in spite of God recognizing his ability, he didn't. As you know, he argued and he argued till he even made God angry with him because he made so many excuses. And then his final excuse was the one that we always use. That's our best excuse. Find somebody else to do it. Right? That's usually, I can say, we say, somebody ought to do it or anybody can do it, but don't look to me to do it. And then we have Jeremiah, who was, when he was called of God to go and to take his message, God's message to the people, he said, but I'm too young, I don't have any experience. And God said, I will teach you, I will be with you. And I find Jeremiah's case a little sort of difficult because we're used, when God calls us to do something, we're used to seeing it accomplished. God called Jonah to go to preach to the Ninevites. When Jonah preached, the whole city repented and was converted. But and in our people like Billy Graham, when they preached, loads of people were converted. When Jeremiah preached, nobody paid any attention to him, even though he preached with tears. But we have to remember when God calls us for something and to use the talent that we have, he doesn't expect you to bring the result. You just have to be faithful in doing what God wants you to do. And remembering too, when Jesus called his disciples, he called the most unlikely group of people that you would have called to go out to be evangelists and convert and change the whole world. He called fishermen. What do they know about preaching? They only knew about scaling fish and whatnot. He called tax collectors. They were crooks, or they were known to be as crooks. He called the revolutionary Simon, whatever. And so, but Jesus saw in them the potential of what they could be. He didn't see them as they were, but as they could be. And the only one who considered himself an apostle was the Apostle Paul, but he was called after Jesus had gone back to heaven. And he was the only one that had a religious background, but he was the most difficult. When Jesus called the other disciples, they left and they followed him. Paul had to be knocked off his horse because he had a mindset that this Jesus was not real. He was not God's son. He had a mindset that he was to destroy the church that was there at the time. And so sometimes, and I'm talking to us here, sometimes God has a problem getting his message across to people in church, but not always. He did get his message finally across to John Wesley and Charles Wesley. They were priests, and so they were in the church, but they got a heartwarming experience, if you like, and they went to work for the master, maybe taking a slightly different trend, and that's how come we're here today. And the last one I want to use is John Newton, who was a slave trader, and you would have said there can't be nothing much good in him, but God called him, and he became a preacher and a hymn writer. And today we enjoy mostly his hymns, rather. Remind us here this morning that, and before I remind you, I'll remind you of this one. Anyway, they were listening to the preacher preach, and he kept turning over page after page. And finally, when they saw the last page turn, they breathed a sigh of relief, and then he turned them back over and started again. Now, okay, last word is that I would like to challenge us this morning, however deep our talent is hidden, whether we dug a hole in the ground or it's there in the back of your mind, wherever it is, dig it up, brush it off, and it's not too late. None of us are too old. There are all kinds of things we can do. And I was thinking, actually, there are people who we think have no talent. People who can't, they can't cook. Some can't even walk. Some can't even think for themselves. But yet, I found that people who don't have what we consider talents have a better talent for loving and caring for those who are around them, people who can't even talk. I know just use this example. My sister adopted a little child some years back who couldn't talk, she couldn't walk, she couldn't do anything. But that child eventually, they said she would never do anything, but eventually she got to smile. And you know, it's not only that, but it's the joy that you get from helping somebody who's not able to do anything. But you'll always get that reward of a smile back, even if they can't say anything. So may God help us to brush off, dig up our talent, and when you dig it up, plant a tree in the hole, right? And don't be tempted to go and put it back in that hole. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we pray, Lord, that you would water and fertilize that word so that it may bring forth fruit to your honor and to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Earl, for your ministry to us this morning. We trust that the Holy Spirit will follow that word as we depart today. Take my life and let it be consecrated more to thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. From 400, as we conclude our time of worship this morning.
Take my moments and my days.
us and all those we love throughout this day and forevermore. Amen.